All right, this is going to be some tips and tricks for playing Fire Emblem Engage on Maddening difficulty. Now, as I played, I made a few mistakes. I was not expecting Maddening difficulty to be quite as hard as it is in this game, and it is extremely difficult to the point where it's not really that fun. It's satisfying to be able to complete it and get the win, but actually doing the maps is not very fun because of just how difficult it is. Now, the first mistake I made is I kept characters I should have abandoned, primarily this character. She was the first archer you get, and I kind of wanted to have an archer, but the entire game I've been playing this game, she keeps dying. She doesn't have enough hit points, she doesn't have enough defenses, and I wasn't able to keep her stats high enough. Another character I kept and probably shouldn't have is Yunaki. Her stats have not been able to grow enough. She was a thief. And I thought you needed a thief to be able to open up chests and to be able to open up doors, but a thief doesn't, you don't need a thief for that in this game. In the older games, you needed a thief to open chests and open doors. You don't need a thief for that anymore. Anyone can open chests, anyone can open doors, so you don't need the thief class. So you can pretty much drop her. And I, as characters come along, I typically like to pick my characters and then have them grow steadily throughout the game. But on Maddening difficulty, experience is limited. You can't farm experience, there's no way to farm experiences. You have a fixed amount of maps and a fixed amount of experience that you can obtain. So you want to drop players. I was playing this guy right here for a long time because I thought he was kind of funny in his support things, but his stats were too low and I kept him way too long, so he absorbed experience that could have gone to different characters. So you want to abandon characters quickly when characters with higher stats come along. So I could have grabbed, I didn't use this character because he or she is super annoying. This character I should have started using, but I didn't want to drop my archer or my thief. He came along and his stats were really good in comparison. This character's stats were actually incredible. I should have used this character. This character also had pretty good stats, and so did this character. So I could have used any of these characters and dropped my other characters. So when you first start this game, you're going to want to pick a couple of your main characters that you start with. Probably your leader. You want him to get strong. So you want to give him early on all of the experience so he levels up. And then as you grab characters, you're going to have to analyze which ones you want to use permanently. So you get Gold Mary kind of late. You get Ivy kind of late. Chloe's kind of early. So you can do your leader. You can do Chloe. I don't like children in my game, so I didn't use any of the kids, but this character here was actually not her. Which child was actually pretty strong? Maybe it's her. I think she's the princess. I think she was pretty strong, so I should have kept her, but she's a child, so I dumped her ass. She's a child, so I dumped her ass, but she was really strong. Mages are very strong in this game. And the objective for every character is to be able to take one hit and survive. You want, if they get into a situation where an enemy actually hits them, they need to be able to survive. And right now, I have this character can take a hit, this character can take a hit, this one can take a hit, this one cannot. So I need to do something with this character so she can take a hit. I don't know if I need to give her more defense, more speed, whatever, but I need to get this Sage to get a hit. She's really good. Her magic damage is off the charts, so Ivy is extremely strong. But you need to keep her in the back, and you have to be very cognizant that she will never get hit. He can take a hit. She cannot take a hit. This character has been a blight on my entire playthrough just because her stat growth has not been good enough. She started as an archer, and then I moved her into a warrior to try to make her stronger. She has super low speed. Very shit defense, but her strength is pretty strong, so I use her as like a back row archer warrior character, but she can't take a hit. Her hit points are too low, and she hasn't been able to absorb enough experience points, but I have to keep using her, because if you look at her total rating, it's higher than any of the other characters I could replace her with, really. So I've pigeonholed myself into using her, and she's absorbed a bucket load of experience that I should have put towards more powerful characters. Yeah, so you want to be able to apply characters that don't get experience, that are only there as kind of support characters, and abandon them as quickly as possible, which is kind of shitty, because back in older Fire Emblem games, you can get characters like Donald, who starts at level 1, is a super low class. It's like a subclass be- be- below the even starting class, and he becomes one of the most powerful characters you can ever get if you put enough effort into him. So I was kind of hoping that's how she would be. She'd become one of the most powerful if you put enough effort into it, but she is not in Maddening difficulty. So Maddening difficulty, you want to pick your characters that you want to get experience early on and get them experience. So if you, let's say you start with six characters, you want to pick three of them and give those three characters most of the experience, and the other three characters you want to use as like support characters, and then abandon them as new characters come along. So if I were to rate these characters how they leveled up for me, the leader is like a B class. He's not that great. He's pretty good, but he's gotten the most experience out of all of them. You see his rating is 216. I've leveled him up through four different classes. He started as dragon, or the pre-dragon, dragon, and then sword. Okay, three. So he's about to master sword master, and then I'm going to put him back to dragon. Gold Mary is like a C. She's all right. She starts out pretty strong. Chloe starts out as your winged bird character, and she has an extremely high level of speed, but her defense is kind of trash. So Chloe, you could probably get rid of her. I kept her because she's got the heavy chest, and so does Gold Mary. So these are my two chesticle characters, and you got to have some chesticle characters, and I guess she is too. But Ivy's strong all around. She starts as a bird mage. I don't know the exact classes, and I just changed her to a sage. I wish that some hit points would be added to her. I used it all the permanent buffs on the main character. So she's pretty strong. This guy's pretty strong. She's trash. I should have abandoned her. I should have abandoned him as well, but he was the first tank character. And tank characters aren't as good in this game as they are in previous characters. The generals, there's too many mages. There's too many ways to take out tank characters in this game, so they've been tuned down a little bit. In previous games, the generals were like one of the strongest characters. You put them in front, they absorb all the damage, and then that's that. So that's the first tip, is to plan ahead and optimize your experience gain and your experience curve and be able to drop characters. I should have dropped her. The dancer is great. This guy is shockingly good, and he's one of the later characters that I got. You start out only using 8 characters, and it ups to 10, and by the end, it's allowing you to use 12 characters. I don't like her. She dies super easy. I can't put her in the front lines. I can't put her anywhere near the front lines, and she's super late. But she's better than the other ones that I had. I probably, if I were to gauge, I probably should have kept this character, and probably either him or him. I should have put these in as soon as I got them. I probably should have kept using her, despite that she's a kid, because she was very strong early on. And this character is also pretty strong. Immediately, I should have replaced this thief. She was a thief. Should replace her with him as soon as I got him, because this is also a thief. You don't really need a thief in this game. They're kind of strong. They got high dodge, but they're not that great. I would avoid the thief class. Now let's take a look at some of the classes, and I'll just give my quick opinions on the classes and their pros and cons. Divine Dragon, he's solid across the board. He's just kind of average across the board. He has a pretty high rating. The hero's lame, kind of lame. I don't recommend anyone being a hero. Gold Mary starts as a hero, and I switched her as quickly as possible. I have one Halberd, which is Tamara. They're okay. They have higher stats than a hero, in my opinion, and they can get an S rank on the spear. So characters like a hero that use two weapons, they can't really get an S rank on the spear. So they seem better than they actually are, because you can use two different weapon types. But being able to S rank on a character allows you to use some of the better weapons. So my Tamara, who has an S rank in her spears, is able to use this spear here, which is one of the stronger spears in the game. I only have it a +1 because I've been poor the entire time, because Maddening is extremely difficult. But because she has an S rank, she's able to use this S rank spear. And I imagine at some point I'm going to get a better S rank spear as well. That's a 2 range. I imagine I'm going to get it up close. Hopefully I can get an S rank heavy spear that just hits like a truck and knocks people back. But that's different. That'll determine whether I get it or not. Not trade. Let's go back to manage. Change class. Well, let's go back to my main character. So they're okay. They're good because they can get an S rank. Berserkers are kind of trash. Their defenses are too low. For maddening, their defense is just too low for maddening. So you don't want to use berserkers. Warriors are cool because they can use a bow, and they do more damage than a sniper. So if you look at a warrior versus a sniper, the strength of the warrior is higher by 4 points. So you're gonna hit harder, and the speed is also better. So the berserker, the warrior, is a better archer than a sniper. And I haven't gotten an S rank bow. The good bows are the long bow to give you an additional range. And then like a silver bow is perfectly fine. Or if you have a high magic class, this character here is absolutely incredible because of his, his magic isn't that high anymore. But when I first got him, his magic was extremely high at 13, but it hasn't scaled well as he's leveled. And I have him as sniper, so his magic is lower. But that radiant bow, this radiant bow is absolutely spectacular. Radiant bow with this character, he's a godsend. He's fantastic. Radiant bow does magic damage instead of regular damage, so you shred out all their tanks. And there's a lot of dragon knights, and those just get wrecked by the radiant bow because I think it doubles up. It hits them with the arrow, which is strong against flyers, and it hits them with the magic, which is strong against dragons. So I'm pretty sure that's a double hit. He'll kill almost every dragon in one shot with that radiant bow. She has a radiant bow, but her magic is one, right? So you're not going to be able to do any damage with a magic of one. Probably ought to put her to some type of archer with her magic, but, you know, maybe not. Or Ivy. You can put Ivy as an archer and give her the radiant bow, and she's going to be shredding. Absolutely shredding. But as a mage, she can do more damage. But if I put her as a warrior with a radiant bow, she's going to do a lot of damage as well. So the warrior is a pretty good class. Archer sniper, shockingly bad class. I kept that one archer. It's just kind of a bad class around the board. You can get an S rank on a bow, but so far I haven't gotten an S rank bow. When I get an S rank bow, maybe the sniper is worth it. But so far, skip out on the sniper and the archer. Bow knight, also kind of skip out on, because a bow knight is worse than the warrior. Only reason you want a bow knight is because it gave you extra hit, which is good for, I forget the flyers. I can go down here and show it. These griffin knights, which there's not a lot of, but then there's also the, it doesn't show you every class with every character. And I'm going to go to different characters to get different classes. But there's a flyer class that can use staves and spears, and they have high evasion, super hard to hit, and they will wreck you if you don't have a lot of hit. So you definitely want some hit on characters. The paladins are lame. Don't use paladins. They're weak. Ren knights are super good, except for the fact they're weak against bows and magic. So they can become a high target for being killed in one shot. They can get a lot of one shots against them. So it's a little risky to play them. Right now I got a lot of Ren Knights. It just kind of happened that way. Swordmaster is an incredible class. You get that evasion high. But the problem with the Swordmaster is the super low defensive scaling. So if you don't evade, you're going to get wrecked and you're going to use a lot of your time travels. And you only get 10 time travels. So you kind of have to learn how to play each map rather perfectly. Royal Knights, the specialty classes are all extremely good. So Gold Mary doesn't get a specialty class, but I'm pretty sure Ivy gets a specialty class. I don't know if this is special to just Ivy, but this class is really strong. Flies and does magic. You can see from a Mystical Sage, you can get 5 extra defense. You drop some speed and some dex, but you get that extra defense so you can survive a hit. So this class is extremely strong. Dun, dun, dun. Let's take a look. The High Priest is really good. But the High Priest kind of sacrifices some of the magic damage to be able to use staves and fist. And it loses the ability of the Martial Monk, which is the guard skill. I forget what it's called. You can guard and protect the person in a four spots around you, which is extremely handy. And I have that on this dancer character. This is one of the best classes, one of the best characters in the game. It lets you use an extra turn, and it has a guard skill that's extremely useful for setting up a turn. You put your tankiest character in front, then you put one of these people behind it, you use guard, you draw the enemies in, and then you attack them, or you keep just kind of falling back and letting them hit. The current map I'm stuck on, that's kind of my strategy, is I draw the enemies in, and then I kill them. But the current map I'm stuck on is map 24, and you have a 15-turn limit. So the entire play strategy that I've used of being rather defensive instead of offensive and drawing the enemies in, it does not work on this map, and I failed it 3 times now. Get really close to the end, and then I run out of time travels, or they get a lucky crit. It's very annoying. I kind of hate it. But I refuse to drop it down to hard. I don't recommend anyone playing Maddening because it is actually maddening. The difficulty is not balanced at all. It's kind of dog shit. Now, another thing that is good to know, for the most part, you can ignore the individual personal stats. Everyone's got a personal stat. You can kind of pay attention to it if you really want to, but that becomes a lot of details to try to remember. If you really want to go high level, you can remember each one of these personal stats, but for the most part, I ignore that. I'm not going to pay attention to each one. Like this one, if two female allies are adjacent within 2 spaces, it takes 2 less damage during combat. I'm not going to remember that this is a dude, and if there's chicks around him, he's going to do more damage. I'm just not going to remember that. Yeah, I'm not going to remember these actual things. But if you can memorize those, it might help you out. But what you do want to memorize is your actual, emblem rings. What your emblem rings do and who has what emblem ring. So I kind of made mistakes as I was playing it as, let's take a look. So we have, whenever I max out the bond, I kind of want to switch emblems. But I do think in Maddening difficulty, you're better off to pick one emblem for one hero and just keep it. Because the bonuses stack the higher the bond. So if we go to my main character here, let me look at some of these rings. Look at my stats. Which one? I have a bond 17 here. You can see I get 3 more res and 4 magic because my bond is maxed out on Corrin. And if I have a 1 bond, I'm getting much lower stats. So you want to, I think it's probably best just to pick 1 emblem, maybe 2. So right here, Sigurd, I get 4 dex, 4 defense with Sigurd, and a ton of move, plus 3 build. You get plus 1 move when you have this as a thing. So as my main character, sometimes I'd need to run super far. I'd run, I'd hit, I'd back up, then I would dance on him, and then run forward even more. And I probably should just keep it on Sigurd the whole time, or pick a character that you want. Like Marth gets good because it's strength, speed, and dex. So you probably want to just pick 1 emblem for each character and keep it on there forever. Now there's another reason you want to do that, because while playing the game, there's kind of a lot to think about in this game, more so than other Fire Emblem games. And you want to try to memorize what character has what emblem. And when you're switching emblems around, you're switching out the special abilities that each character can do. But if you don't switch them out, you kind of memorize what each one of your characters are do and what the emblem they have equipped can do. And it's super annoying because emblems like Corrin, which is one of the best emblems in the game, and Blythe has Goddess Dance. If you switch these around, you'll fuck yourself over because you'll want to be able to use the Goddess Dance, which gives 4 people an extra turn. And you might put it on the wrong character, and then you move the wrong character there, and you forgot that you switched your Goddess Dance emblem over, or you have to keep checking who has it. But if you just put it on one character, leave it forever, you won't forget it. And your bond is going to give you much better stats when you're at a high bond. So I think I made that mistake early on by switching the emblems over to give multiple emblems. On mad, it probably works on hard and normal difficulty, or if you put it to casual, but who plays casual? Permadeath is the only way to play Fire Emblem. If you're playing casual, I don't have any respect for you, and you're not playing the same game as everyone else. There's a shared experience when you play a game that's difficult, like Dark Souls or these Fire Emblems that have permanent death. The people that are playing on Classic are playing a completely different game than the people that are playing on casual. They're not getting the same gaming experience. And for this game, because the story and the dialogue are so absolute trash, the only reason you're playing this game is for the tactical combat in the game. So when you're playing the tactical combat in the game, the only way to make the tactical combat important is playing classic mode, not casual mode. So classic hard is probably what I recommend everyone play. Classic maddening, the difficulty is way too overtuned. It's not enjoyable. I'm not having that good of a time playing it. I should go down to hard for these last, I think there's two maps left. I'm on 24. Feels like it's going to go to 26. It might be 25. There might be one map left, but I should drop it down to hard, but I'm stubborn and I want to be able to say and get the like satisfying feeling of beating on the hardest difficulty. So that would be the next tip, is one, to memorize what each one of these characters do. And then secondly, to be able to not switch your rings over and to have each person just keep their emblem ring, and that's it. The next is DLC. For maddening difficulty, you're gonna want DLC. I hate to say it, it is a bit pay to win. I haven't gotten the new DLCs, but I got Hector, but there's two more I gotta go get. But you get Edelgard from the DLC. She's okay. Her house units, she's one of the strong ones. But Tiki is absolutely incredible and one of the definitely the best emblem in the game. And she's a part of the DLC. This divine blessing will give you an extra life. And I'm pretty sure she's the one that gives you Star Sphere. So let's... do I have to go? I think I have to go to the place to level it up. But this character here, Alfred was kind of lacking stats. So I gave Alfred, I think I can go to it from the skill section, which is from the inventory section. I was able to give Alfred, he was the first person I was able to give this skill, Star Sphere. Grants units enhanced stat. I can't even talk. Grants unit enhanced stat growth when leveling. So I was able to put this on him pretty early. So his stat growth has actually improved far better. He might not be that great of a character, but for me, because I was able to slap that on him early, his stat growth has been phenomenal. And he's now probably like my second strongest character. I think I have it on him as well. So if you're able to put the, yeah, this Star Sphere currently overlaps. Oh no. Wait, yeah, so has Tiki on him at the moment, and it overlaps, so I probably want to move Tiki to someone else so they can get that, but it's late in the game, so it's kind of pointless now. I didn't realize there was DLC until I was on chapter 20, so I've only had like four, maybe lower than 20, but I've only had a couple maps with Tiki, and it made it super easy having Tiki and getting this. But if you're just starting out and you can do the DLC earlier than later, getting this Tiki and putting this Star Sphere is going to be able to create gods, because that's kind of the goal in maddening mode, is to make each character kind of a god in themselves, to the point where they're not going to die if they get put in bad situations. So that would be my advice with the rings. So let's take a look at these emblem rings, and I will review the emblem rings. Marth is pretty strong because Lodestar Rush can wreck people, and Rapier is strong against armored units. Selka has a warp Ragnarok where she could teleport to people and then hit them with a strong magic spell. But you're going to be putting that on a mage, and it's going to put you into danger zones a lot. So she's not that great. She's good because she can pump up magic damage. But very dangerous, because it's going to put you in your mages into dangerous situations. Sigurd is excellent because they give you Canter Plus, which allows you to move after combat. He's probably, if I were to rank it, he'd be S tier. He's up there for some of the best. Quadruple hits okay. He's just kind of average. He has good stat growth, I believe, because he gives you hit points and defense, so it's good for, you know, this. He is a strength monster. Roy will give you a ton of strength. You see, if I put Roy on him, I have him maxed out. I like getting the strength. But leveling up this emblem to get the strength, I'm going to go to the emblem area. So I can actually look at learning some of these. So you can see some of the growth requirements. Roy is very expensive to get these high strength ones. Until I got the DLC, I didn't quite understand how you would manage to even get that much SP. But if you look at Roy, I'll just talk to him. I'll use this area to talk to him with my... So if we go to Roy, to get plus 6 strength, it's 6,000 SP. I don't even think you're going to get 6,000 total SP throughout the entire thing. You're going to probably get like 4,000 total. But when you get the DLC, you get these items that give you extra SP. But each character is probably only going to get a total of 4,000 SP throughout the entire playthrough. So let's start with Marth. Some of Marth's, this sword ability is not very good. Plus 30 avoid, minus 10 crit. Avoid isn't very good. Dodge is much better. Her stats, this plus magic is extremely strong. So you're going to want to put her on a mage. So despite her ability of being able to teleport and put your mages in danger, it's good to get a level 19 on her because you can get plus 5 magic. Hit is actually very strong in this game. As I was saying, you have those flyer monsters that are very strong with hit. So getting plus 30 hit is pretty strong. Lance power is strong because it gives it plus attack on lances and minus avoid. So if you, like, let's say you have a general. If you want a general, you do plus hit and then plus lance power. He's going to hit like a truck. But Sigurd's mostly good for canter. If you put this on every character, this is an S skill. Every character can move after they do combat. Very nice thing to have on Sigurd. And you get it, I think, like right out the back. Well, he's already level 20, so it doesn't say what level you get access to this. But if I were to replay this game, I'd make sure everyone has canter. It's just super valuable. I don't really know what build does in this game. If build is strong, then this is your character to give build. Knives are kind of useless. And they're not useless. When I had my thief with my silver knife, she was pretty strong. But there's a lot of characters who just get so much defense that knives are not going to do zero damage. You'll attack with the knife and it just won't do any damage. So I don't recommend knives on Madden difficulty just because their defense is so high that you won't get any benefit for it. So basically, Vantage is kind of good. And Vantage Plus, and if you can get Vantage Plus Plus, if hit points is 75% or less and foe initiate combats, units can counter before the first attack. So this is good if you put your like tanky boy in the front lines and then people attack him and your tanky boy can kill them before they even kill, before they can get a hit off. Super strong. I should put this on my main character because he runs out. So strategy you can use. Oh, I guess I can talk about the strategy here. You get your main character who has Vantage Plus. You send him out to the front lines and use Leaf on him, or Tiki. Tiki has... Oh, it's part of her main thing. She can give you an extra life with Tiki. It doesn't say it here. You have to go to the emblem room. So it'll say he has Tiki. This Divine Blessing. Pretty sure X does details. Yeah, so let's go to Divine Blessing. And you can see it grants one ally a Revival Stone. So when you fight bosses in this game, you have to kill them multiple times. So it gets you a Revival Stone. So you can be at low hit points and not worry about dying. Because when you die, you use this Revival Stone. So a really good combo would be to get... Bum, bum, bum. Leaf's Vantage Plus, be below 75 hit points, so when anyone comes and attack you, you counter before they hit you, and if you hit twice, which you probably will if you have high speed, you're gonna wreck most people who try to attack you. You get Vantage, and then you put an extra life on your character who has Vantage. You throw him out in front, and everyone will rush him. He'll hit, he'll counter, and if he gets into trouble, he'll revive himself and hit and counter. A very good combo to be able to use, and you want that kind of combo in maddening difficulty. So that character is pretty strong. Again, Roy is really strong just because you can get a plus 6 strength. And Holdout is a strong ability. Holdout Plus is real strong. If unit has 2 hit points or more at the start of combat, unit always survives with at least 1 hit point. This is also a really strong ability to have with Tiki's revival. Because let's say you have 50 hit points, you get hit down with a really strong hit that knocks you to 3. And then that second hit is only going to knock you to 1. So you're going to survive. So no one can really kill you in one shot. You can't be one shot. So holdout is extremely strong, which is why it's super expensive. And if you have a revive, so let's say the enemy's hitting you with 1,000,000 damage every hit, and you have a revive on your character and holdout, you're going to get hit with 1,000,000. It's only going to do damage enough to 1 hit points. So then they got to hit you again, and then it will kill you. Then you'll revive. They'll hit you for 1,000,000 on the next hit. So they got to hit you 4 times with 1,000,000 damage in order to actually kill your character. So holdout, very strong ability. This character, Alacree's pretty strong because you get attacked twice if you have enough high speed. Speed Taker's pretty strong. Anyone who has Speed Taker, they get +2 speed each time they initiate combat and defeat a foe. And you can get a max of 10 speed. And with 10 speed, you're basically going to double hit everyone. But you kind of have to prioritize whoever has Speed Taker to get the kills. And everything else is pretty dog shit. This +30 hit and -10 dodge, you want your archers to have some dodge. 5 speed is pretty awesome. And the fact that it's really low value to get 5 speed. It's super cheap to get it because I already have it leveled up to 3. But I think it is cheaper than all the other ones. Like 5 strength is way more expensive than 5 speed. But speed is not that useful. It only determines whether you do a double hit or take a double hit. So you just want enough to where you're not taking a double hit. You don't necessarily need to do a double hit that often. Yeah, never mind. Speed's strong, but you got to make sure your character is designed around speed. Like, my main character right now is a sword master, so the speed is very useful on a sword master. But having a lot of speed on a general is not going to be that good, because the general's speed is actually capped, and you're going to hit your speed cap, and you're never going to be able to benefit from the speed as much. But Lin calls doubles, and those doubles have a lot of, like, priority targets. They're priority targets, so the enemies will go to the doubles. So Lin is actually quite strong on Maddening mode, because you can call your doubles out, and then they'll target those doubles. And when those doubles die, you can actually recall the doubles again. So that is a really strong ability. So Lin is up there on the strong ones to use. Erica is a beast for killing high defensive enemies with Lunar Brace. And she has a twin strike hit that is excellent when you fight these big salamander dragon things that shoot you from a distance and ignore all defenses, and they will wreck you to shit. But if you're put Erica on as your emblem, you go up, you hit it with a twin strike, and most of the time you're going to kill it in one shot. You're just going to one shot it, and that's the thing. And they can't counter when you hit with that, so you run up, if you don't one shot it, you run up with the character with Erica equipped, you hit the salamander dragon thing, and then you have another character follow up afterwards, and that way that salamander dragon doesn't end up killing you. So she is excellent for taking out defensive character and those salamander dragons. Because most characters won't even hurt the salamander dragon, and his counter will either one shot or two shot you. It'll hit you for like 50 damage, so if you have above 50 life, you'll survive. If you have below 50 life, it's just a one shot kill. And on top of that, these dodge points, 30 dodge is so powerful on a sword master. You get 30 dodge on a sword master, and your sword master just becomes extremely hard to hit. Especially if you go and you hang out in a tree, give you +30 to dodge, and then you get another 30 to dodge, and then the sword master naturally has high dodge, or the fox knights. So Erica, very strong. Ike is also pretty good for setting up defensive, and this +5 defense is really strong. Ike has the passive ability, I don't know if it's resolve, if that's the passive ability, but he has the ability where you run up, it's called Aether. And he could take a lot of damage, and he takes reduced damage when he does so. And then at the start of your next turn, he explodes in a 2-square radius all the way around you. So you can run up whoever has Ike, let them take a bunch of damage. Then he pops and explodes, and he heals himself, and then he attacks. So Ike is actually pretty strong as well. That's how you want to use Ike. You want to put Ike on your tank. Throw your tank in front. Let your tank draw a bunch of damage. Micaiah is extremely powerful. because she has a skill called Sacrifice. So if you put her on your healing mage, it's actually pretty strong. It will fully heal all of your characters, but reduce her life to one. So Makai would probably go pretty good on the Dancer character, because the Dancer mostly gives people extra turns. So you can either use Dancer to give people extra turns or to heal people. It'd also be pretty good on a mage or a tank. The problem with putting Makai on a tank is Makai's bonuses are magic, so you're going to get plus magic for bonuses. And you don't want to put Makai on a character who's going to be too powerful, because you're going to give up your attack turn to use a heal spell to heal everyone. So it's good for characters that are more in a support role than characters that are doing damage. Bow agility is pretty awful. Minus crit and gives you a void. And then Dex. Dex is okay. And these dual assists, that would be the kind of the only really point to do it. But I'm pretty sure Luca is the one that has the guard skill. Which is pretty good, because you can take the damage away from characters in a 4-block square around you. I have to equip her, I think, in order to see it. Actually, I can just find out who, right here. Lucia, Bonded Shield. It's pretty strong in Maddening, because you can reduce the damage. Used to prevent the first attack on adjacent allies on your next turn. Trigger at 80%. Flying triggers 100% for flying allies. I didn't know it triggered 100% for flying allies. But I don't like things that don't trigger for 100%, because that's a chance for this Bonded Shield not to trigger. So you could be planning around it triggering, it not trigger, and then you got to use a Time Crystal, which you only have 10 of. You only have 10 rewinds per match. So it's okay. I would put this one at a lower tier emblem. So let's go. We were at Lucia. So Corrin is different. Look at the fucking pose she's doing. Sticking her butt out. Fucking Japanese people. It's not Japanese people, but she's wanting that D. The way she's sticking her booty out. Wanting that D. She is extremely powerful. I don't really like any of her sword focus is dog shit. Quality time is okay to put on, like, your dancer. Plus 15 hit points is pretty strong for some people. Be able to survive those hits. I've never used Parap. Parap might be alright. But her skills are absolutely spectacular. She can throw, depending on who equips her, she throws different abilities. And if you put it on your main character, I'm actually going to equip it and go do a pretend battle just to show the usefulness of Corrin. Corrin is S-class, best-in-class emblem by far. You put it on the main character and you can do a bunch of different stuff. Main character, your world is your oyster, and you can use all the abilities. You put it to other characters, it's not as good. Right now, the character I have it on, it's giving little avoid puddles, little water puddles that reduce the evasion of enemies and also makes it so it's harder to walk through it. So it's not that great. So I'm using Hector. I should just switch. Let's put on the Corrin.
Corrin, I'll protect you.
Let's just do these tower battles that give you basically useless points. These don't give you experience points, so you can't farm up with these. These just give you these little balls that you can enchant your emblems, weapons with, but I don't find them that useful. I mean, and these take so long that it'd be just very difficult to make it worth your time. I mean, fun combat, but so let's just fight. So Corrin is absolutely spectacular. So you can go in here and use Dragon Vane. When you do it on... Oh. Never mind. It's only... You only get full options if you are a dragon master. So let's do quit, return to the title screen. Yeah, let's return to the title screen. Why not? Actually, I'm not sure I've saved it since I've been doing this. Let's have to retry and then go back. So I'm gonna have to save my game and then switch my class to a dragon. I might just keep it a dragon and not be a swordsman because it is a unique class. The only reason I'm not a dragon is I hit level 20 or 40 with the dragon. And so I switched it to a swordmaster. The evasion on the swordmaster is really nice too. So let's get out of here. Load screens are a little long for a game. This whole open world is what's creating these load screens. And I would rather just not have this sawmill and just be able to do everything through like text commands, like menu options. Everything you can do in this, you can do through menu options, primarily through the reference. You can do your bonds and your supports. And I think it'd be better if these got rid of this whole sawmill for my personality. But a lot of people might like running around this hub and talking to people. I'm only here for the combat. I'm only here for the challenge. So it's not very good. So let's bust some saves. I'm a bit OCD. I played video games way back in the day where losing your save was kind of an option. And games getting corrupted and stuff. So I always create multiple saves. Just in case. Alright. Let's change my class to be able to demonstrate just how strong this character is when you are the Divine Dragon. See, even the Divine Dragon has a less total rating than the class that I am, which is the Sword Master. The Sword Master at the top. Oh, I don't think it shows the class that you actually are. Unfortunately. But don't focus too much on the rating. Focus on what actual stats you're getting. So I increase defense, but I lose dex and speed. And I get extra strength, so it's actually probably a better class, especially because this Swordmaster's defense is stuck at 27. So actually, I'll probably just stay a Divine Child. But I can't use S-class swords, and I have a pretty strong S-class sword on this character. Which is why I'm a Swordmaster. You definitely want some of these specialty classes to be able to use your S-class weapons. So if we take a look at my items, I have these two S-class swords that I use as a swordmaster. They're both extremely strong. I pump this one up to level 5, and it's got nothing on this other one. Of course, this other one has one of the emblems on the weapon to give it more damage, but you can see much stronger. And then this guy is just a beast. If you're only gonna hit once, use this bad boy. He gonna wreck. But you have to be a sword master in order to use it, which is why I became a sword master on the late main character. Now let's redo this and I can demonstrate some of the awesomeness of Corrin. Now on hard difficulty, Corrin's probably not that great. You're wasting a turn doing the ability Dragon Vein or Dragon Veil, whatever it's called. But on maddening difficulty, it's almost crucial. It's extremely useful because you can control a lot of the board and you can prevent people from walking and going places, and you can pigeonhole them off so you can take them out one by one. And with dance, let's make sure I got my dancer selected. Let's get rid of you, put the dancer on, and let's fight. So you can take this main character, pop him here, hit this Dragon Veil, and it'll give you every option. So the ice one creates ice pillars, which you think are pretty good, but they attack the ice pillar and then it goes away. I prefer the flame one for crowd control. So you could drop this flame here. So let's say, show where they can move and where they can attack. You see, they attack everywhere. You can get hit everywhere, but you can take this character, drop them here, Dragon Veil, hit the flame, and people that have to walk through the flame have to walk through slower. So we need to go one farther up like this, Dragon Veil, Flame, like so. Dance on him. Like so. That's that Cantor that's super useful. Get him to right here. Flame. And you can see it reduced where they can move. So now I can move back.
Tell me where.
Tiki being extremely strong. Give Divine Blessing to the main character. Now he has to get killed twice.
Gotcha.
And you can kind of...
Yes?
Group up and control the enemies. And they take 10 damage whenever they stand on it. So let's just end this turn. And it just... Obviously, flyers can fly right over it. So that's where the ice becomes better than that. But you see... Oh, no one was on the fire to take the damage. Let's move these characters out the way. And let's use a little bit more. So in this position, you're probably going to want to use some ice if you're trying to prevent them from coming at you. So you can do... We'll use the ice. Blocks them from walking that way. Dance. And use the ice here. Dragon Vein. Ice. So you can see what the ice can do. Move these out the way.
This isn't so bad.
We can demonstrate the usefulness of Bonded Shield. So that first attack went to the Bonded Shield. See, this is why it's important to not let your characters die in a single hit. There you go. Hit those ice cubes. So that's a good way to control some of the enemies with the ice cubes. Really good for blocking out flyers. Okay. Water... Decreases avoid. This is the one on the character I had it on before. It's not very good. Water's kind of shit. In certain circumstances, it's actually really good if you need to hit an enemy. But I don't think it works on flyers because flyers fly right above it. It only works on non. So like, it's pretty good for sword masters because they have really high dodge. But fog is better because it increases avoid. So this is going to make you dodge very high. So if you're a sword master and you're on an avoid tile, this will just create you an avoid tile and you're gonna avoid it. Veins makes you immune to break. It's not that great. Veil of Successor could be pretty strong if you're bunkering down and holding a position. Use Veil of Successor and then at the beginning of the next turn you heal. And it uses it in a wide area. So it's okay. I probably would never use it that much. Flame, I think, is S tier. Ice is A tier. And those are mostly the two I use. Stone is okay. Increased defense and res. But being able to control positions is far more important in maddening difficulty. And Flame and Ice do that spectacularly. So let's get out of here. Bum 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 system. Let's just quit and return to title screen. Hopefully there's not a huge load time to return to title screen. That's a pretty long load time to return to title screen.
Fire Emblem, engage.
Let's continue. Bum bum bum. And for the most part, I think I'm mostly done with the tips and tricks for playing on. Oh, the swim trunks and the glasses, that helps. You got to be in your swim trunks and your glasses. You got to be pimped out. So you can see your little necklace pimped out in the shades. That's important. It's always an important. It's like putting stickers on your car. Every sticker you put on your car, you get 5 more horsepower. It's extremely important. Emblem rings. There we go. And Edelgard has a pretty important feature. I think you randomly get one of these, but Shield Gambit is extremely powerful. When synced with Dimitri to negate damage from first attack of a ranged foe. Yeah, so Shield Gambit is so, so strong because you can get a flying character like a dragon. Right now, I think I have it on Dimitri. At one point, I had it on Dimitri. Who do I have it on right now? Dimitri now has Tiki, but for the longest time, I had Edelgard with Dimitri. So let's put that on.
Edelgard,
we shall win.
Edelgard. And then this is a DLC character, and you got this Shield Gambit and Dimitri. Or Diamant. I don't know how you say his name. I call him Dimitri. I don't know why, because Dimitri is a normal name, and Diamant is not a normal name. You put it on him as a flyer. He's weak to archers, but he also wrecks archers. So you fly him to some archers. He has more speed than the archers, so the archers aren't going to get an attack twice. They can only attack from range, usually. And then you put this Shield Gambit on. Shield Gambit, you're going to negate the first ranged damage. It also good for those ranged damage salamanders. So the archer's going to shoot you. It's going to do no damage. You're going to counter with your tomahawk, probably hit twice, and kill the archer. So the archers will come to you, shoot you, and then die in return. Pretty good little combo. I just got Hector, so I don't have anything to say about him just yet. And Blythe is excellent for Goddess Dance. That'll give you extra turns. And Instruct is also pretty strong. Instruct with the dragon does +3 to all stats in a circle. So at the start of the match, you can actually kind of use the emblem. Then get Instruct with all your characters together at the start of the map. The map. Then you can continue out the map with those extra bonuses. So that's pretty good. Let me think. Any other tips and tricks for playing on maddening mode? Take a break. When you lose a match, feel free to take a break because it will get you mad. Let's take a look. I am 164 hours in. This is like a 40 to 60 hour game if you were to play on normal. But when you're playing on maddening difficulty, each map can take you up to, I think my longest one was 12 hours with all my deaths. You're probably looking at an average of 1 to 3 hours per chapter, per map. Some you can get done much quicker, but others will take much longer. Very slow. I do not recommend anyone play Maddening and Classic unless you are a glutton for punishment. All right, those are my tips and tricks for playing Maddening difficulty on YouTube. There is only like one guy posting Maddening videos, and you just search Maddening. I think he's completed the whole game now in Maddening mode, and he recorded each one of his maps. He's a good reference. Watch how he plays. He doesn't give tips and tricks, but you can kind of absorb by watching how he plays. If you're really stuck on a map, watch him do it. It might help you out. I haven't had to watch him do it yet, but I did get stuck on, I think, Chapter 13. And then I saw him playing, and that's how I saw that there was DLC. He had a character called Tiki, and he used it a ton, and it helped him win the match. And I was like, well, that's no fair. The only reason I'm not winning the match is because I don't have that. So I had to go get the DLC to get it. And then I completed the match. But without DLC, completing this game in Maddening difficulty without the DLC Now that is a feat that at some point I would love to try to conquer and try to complete. But the first time playing through, especially since I messed up with my characters, I'm not going to do that. If I restarted this game, I'd be much better off because I can abandon lower stat characters much quicker and not get attached to them and force myself to use them just because I used them from the beginning. And then restrict the amount of experience points that people I plan on abandoning get and apply those experience points to the characters I plan on keeping. And then staying with the emblems for each character. Just one emblem per character, max it out, max bond, and then keep that character with that emblem the entire time. You do those, you're going to do pretty well in maddening difficulty. It's still very difficult. I think Fire Emblem is broken at the moment, which is difficulty. Back in the day, Fire Emblem had a fixed difficulty and everyone played on the same difficulty. It was classic mode and it was hard. It was hard by default. It was classic mode by default. So everyone who played Fire Emblem was playing the exact same game, getting the exact same difficulty experience. So when one person beat a map, when one person beat the game, you knew the game they played was the same game you played. And you're having a shared experience in difficulty, much like Dark Souls. There's no easy mode in Dark Souls because the creators of Dark Souls wants everyone to have a shared experience in the difficulty level. I very much enjoy that, and they've ruined it by setting so many difficulty options in Fire Emblem, and I hope they revert it. And by doing that, they've had to balance the game around easy mode and casual. You play it on easy and casual, you're not even playing a game. You might as well do auto battle because you're going to win every match with auto battle, and it's absolutely pointless. But they've had to scale the difficulty to account for easy mode, meaning that the most difficulty mode, maddening mode, is far too overtuned because they have to account for easy mode as well. I've played every Fire Emblem game that has been made, and this one is the least balanced on its highest difficulty. There was one on the DS, I forget which one it was, it was one of the last two that came out, the one with like the red-headed swordsman. Came out just before the mobile title Heroes. It had a pretty off-balance difficulty level too, but this is even worse. And I think it's just going to keep getting worse and worse and worse with every iteration on the hardest difficulty being unfun and overtuned and imbalanced. I hope they remove the difficulty options. I think I'm kind of fine with the classic and the not classic. The classic and casual, I think I'm okay with that one because some people are just really, they really don't want their character to die and then have to restart the entire map because your character died. But then again, at the same time, you have the time crystals to be able to rewind time. So if you mess up and your character dies, you just rewind time, you get 10 of those per map. So I think they also need to get rid of casual mode. Get rid of casual mode. Maybe you have two difficulties, normal and hard. So that way you can tune it much better. That'd be my advice for the thing. That was my advice on how to play maddening mode. I don't recommend it, but if you do want to play maddening mode, hopefully this video helped. That is all.